Ladies and gentlemen, another week has passed. We are here. Let's get into this. We're going to talk about three great little topics today. We're going to talk about the PS5. We'll focus on hardcore gamers, Google Stadia's pricing plans, and Nintendo will be doubling down its stance on censorship, stating how it will actually inhibit the industry. So it's going to be a pretty interesting week for review. So let's get right into it and please enjoy. So we're going to talk about how Sony is going to be targeting the PlayStation 5 towards the hardcore gamer. Personally, I don't really know what Sony thinks is a hardcore gamer, when quite a few of their exclusives are really just third-person action-adventure games with stealth elements. So, hardcore, personally, I don't think that's where we're going to fall into, unless you're talking about something like a 4X game or a MOBA, I would think would be far more hardcore than those games that Sony's putting out, or even just a sense of something in that line. But let's not get too far off the main topic. I do have to unfortunately go to reset era for a lot of these quotes because the Wall Street Journal likes to use a paywall, and I'm not going to be supporting them. So here are the quotes. Sony sees Microsoft as its main competitor in the next generation, with Google a potential threat in the mid to long term as internet technology advances. One company official said Nintendo isn't perceived as a major rival. Personally, I think that's going to be a bad move. Nintendo has actually already outsold the PS4 in Japan. They better get their stuff together, if you know what I mean. Mostly because its main users tend to be younger than PlayStation's core demographic. I could see that as debatable. PlayStation has been one of the most successful mass market products of the past quarter century. The PS4 alone is expected to pass 100 million units this year. Sony's latest thinking puts less stress on overall sales numbers and more on the most profitable segment of the market, the devoted fans who buy big budget titles such as Bethesda Softworks LLC's Fallout series. I'm sorry, I couldn't even finish that sentence without laughing. And Take-Two's Interactive Software's Red Dead Redemption. Sure. I get, yes, Red Dead sold well, but Fallout, that's the wrong thing to say, buddy boy. A second Sony official said the company believes people will buy a video game console to play graphics-heavy games. if you want graphics-heavy games, my boy, you're going to be building yourself what's called a personal computer, and you're going to be getting yourself a graphics card that blows the pants off any current or next gen console coming out, so you can have that seat, my boy. They continue. Sony is concentrating its attention on large software publishers as it gets ready for the next PlayStation, according to executives at Sony and software makers. In general, publishers want their games on multiple platforms to maximize sales. While console makers look to make deals for exclusive content for initial period of exclusive sales. That's bad. See, it's bad when Epic does it. It's also bad if Sony does it. We don't want that kind of exclusivity. If you're going to make an exclusive, make it out of your own development studio. Don't try to look to make deals for exclusive content or initial period of exclusive sales. Nobody likes doing that. Nobody likes it having it done to them. So how about don't do it? Hey, don't be a Tim Sweeney. Sort of like a good message, you know what I mean? Some executives at smaller game makers say that they have felt snubbed by Sony in contrast to Nintendo. And yet, Sony feels Nintendo is not a rival? Ouch. At the Tokyo Game Show in September, Nintendo is supporting events to showcase independent game developers. And Sony used to do the same, but isn't planning to this year. I can honestly see where that logic is coming from on Sony's side. When the PS4 first launched, a lot of indie titles were really relevant on that console, but since they've gotten a few more, I would say, pretty popular titles that are taking the lead throughout that hardware cycle for the PS4, so they're probably going to be focusing more on those in the first hand. So that does make sense, but it's never a bad thing to also implement your indies to fill those gaps when you're waiting on a AAA big budget game from Sony that's just a once again, third-person cover-based action game with stealth elements. But, you know, that's just me and my opinion. You can get mad about it if you want. It's okay. Sony still welcomes games from independent studios, the first Sony official said, but the emphasis is on strengthening relationships with large publishers since resources are limited. The thinking is that people buy a console to play high-quality games available only on that platform, not smaller games also available on smartphones. Yikes! Well, indie games aren't always available on smartphones, that's first and foremost. And this whole statement really reads as some classic Sony. All of this really reads to me as Sony coming off the PS2 from a big win and then being very robust and full of themselves and walking into the PS3 as the big dog. And I really hope they don't repeat that same mistake, because that was a horrendous mistake to have in the first place of $599. This is something that I think Sony should be very cautious of, although them implementing, you know, sequels for their games like Horizon and God of War and Spider-Man and etc. are good things, because those are pretty good games. They're not excellent, in my opinion. It's definitely good to still have those big blockbusters that they're going to be wanting to put out from their own development studios, but yet have that gaps in between with those indie studios there. Mentioning things like Fallout, saying things like Nintendo is not a major rival, that is a little bit pig-headed in my personal opinion, and I think this is the typical Sony that we've come to expect from the past, that they sort of get too big for their britches, and they may get put down faster than they think if they go that route from before. So hopefully this isn't something that's going to be continuing in that behavior, but from what I'm seeing with these reps, a lot of it is just the boasting of what they're doing. And there are unfortunately people that will gobble this sort of crap up as like, Sony the best, Sony's number one, Sony always wins, which is just silly. You're a customer of a plastic box. There really shouldn't be any reason why you're defending a company. You shill, you absolute shill. But this whole style and this whole like putting down of other types of games and other companies just seems really shitty, and we'll see what happens. But I don't know about you, but I personally don't think that the games that they're putting out are quote-unquote hardcore. They're pretty casual and appeal to the largest group of people, so they're going to be quite watered down. I mean, it's not like you're playing a 4X game or Total War. You're playing just a typical game that is really story heavy and story driven, or you're not really doing much. So maybe tone that down, Sony. Tone that down. So here's a new one. We're going to talk about Google Stadia, and it looks like Google doesn't know how to set up pricing for video games or for their service. The article we're pulling here is from The Sun, awkwardly, I'm using a British source for this, but let's see what Google has done and what they have to say. Right off the bat, here we go. Google, the tech giant, has now revealed that you're going to be paying the same price for games on Stadia as on a normal console, even though you won't actually get to keep them.
What? What the fuck?
So what you're telling me is, not only do I have to worry about data caps, Google, not only am I going to be shelling out the $9.99 monthly fee to be able to play those games anywhere in whatever quality you think is going to be playing, but now I have to go ahead and buy those games up front that I don't even get to keep anymore. Ladies and gentlemen, we have hit the dystopian era of video games, what every single publisher and developer has always ever wanted, and that's for you to never have any control of the product that you purchase. You don't have any rights to it. You don't have any control over it. You can't touch it. You can't mod it. You can only play it when they allow you to play it. And you're going to have to pay for it at full price. Granted, we don't do distribution anymore. Server cost is actually at an all-time low. You're going to have to worry about your data caps and ISPs. And then at the same time, here we go. Give me that sweet, sweet $60 plus DLC, plus microtransactions, plus everything else. Pay Google, pay your ISP, and then you don't even get to keep the game, because if the servers ever go down, kaput, goodbye. You're never going to touch it again. Fantastic, isn't it? How nice is that of Google to do for us? It's so great. I don't even think this is... I'm going to call it right now. I think Google Stadia is going to be dead on arrival. It will hit for about a month or two, but then fade away like the Ouya. Remember Google Fiber, kids? We thought we were going to have Ethernet for everybody. Nope. That's done. The sun continues. Unlike normal consoles where you buy a copy of the game to run at home, on Google you just buy the right to stream the game from Google servers for as long as it's there. Wait a minute. They can take away the game too? So hold on. You pay the $9.99, you pay the $60, and then when they take the fucking game away, you're done. Many had hoped these differences would mean Stadia game prices would be lower than you'd pay for Xbox One or PS4, but Google has shot this down. Oh boy. Okay, here we go. Phil Harrison said, I don't know why buying games on Stadia would be cheaper. The value you get from the game on Stadia means you can play it on any screen in your life. TV, PC, laptop, tablet, phone. He told a gathering of UK games media. I think that's going to be valuable to the players. Hey, smart guy. We can already do that with our consoles and our PCs. And we don't have to give you $9.99. And we also keep the game. So, Phil Harrison... You goofed, big boy. Oh, man, you sure did goof. Oh, Google Stadia, dead on arrival. And now we bring it to Nintendo, where they are, in fact, doubling down on their stance with censorship in the industry, saying that it's actually something that inhibits the games industry. And honestly, I tend to agree with them. I don't think any of these companies are parents or should dictate to us what we can and can't see. I know that there are going to be people saying, well, what about all of the supposed content of minors in a inappropriate manner on games? Well, that's pretty shitty. And honestly, I'm not a fan of it. I don't like it. And I'm not going to support it. And that's how I will make sure that it doesn't succeed. But I don't need a company telling me what I can and can't look at. Especially when Sony's been doing that to a lot of their bigger games. Well, bigger games on their consoles like Devil May Cry 5, which is not for children, is for mature adults, and there are adults in that game, yet that game was censored, weirdly enough. So here we go. Sony has faced backlash lately over the policy changes regarding censorship. Several games have had their content altered to conform to these guidelines. Nintendo, however, has been relaxing its policies on this in recent years. Thanks to this, the unaltered versions have often found a home on the Switch. Nintendo recently reaffirmed this policy during the annual general meeting of shareholders, which is honestly the right move. Nintendo has been notorious about censoring its games. We can all go back to the Mortal Kombat fiasco in the 90s, when they censored that game completely. So, here's a pretty good quote from Nintendo themselves. Nintendo, as do third parties in their software, applies for an objective rating from third-party organizations prior to release. If the platform holding companies choose arbitrarily, the diversity and fairness in game software would be significantly inhibited. We provide parental controls that can be used to apply limits. Perfect. That's exactly how it should be. There are third-party ratings boards that apply for those games to have that rating. And if the platform holding companies choose arbitrarily, the diversity and fairness of the game software would be inhibited. Which makes a lot of sense. Because now what's happening is that company is choosing what you can and can't look at, which is pretty shitty. And that limits what kind of games you can actually play. And then, in turn, will reduce the sales of what happens on your system. So, Nintendo just did the smart thing. They provide you parental controls, and you can apply those limits personally for your kids and your family. So, Sony saying it's for the children is the same concept that they said about crossplay. They're here to protect the kids. Well, that's pretty shitty. There are parental controls on everything that you can use, and if Sony wants to protect the kids, give parental controls in their consoles. Sony's not my mom. Sony's not my dad. any gaming company. It's not my mom or my dad. I'm a grown adult with responsibilities of my own and a child of my own. I think I can determine what I can and can't play, what my child can and can't play. It's very simple. A company shouldn't dictate that for me. And that's pretty much the rub. But anyways, let me know what you think in the comment section down below of any one of these three topics. I hope you enjoyed today's video. If you'd like my content, go ahead and subscribe. I'll be back again next Sunday with another three hot takes, and we'll go from there. So please have a great week, stay safe, and go out there and do the one thing that you'd always wanted to do, and that's play some video games. I'll see you guys next time.